I thank all the television audience for tuning in to the planning board this evening. The first item on the agenda is the reading of the minutes of the previous meeting. However, since the planning board is without a secretary at this point, we do not have minutes of that meeting. However, we do have minutes in our packet of the April 4th workshop meeting with the South Portland Planning Board. And do I hear a motion to accept those minutes?
Mrs. Beverly, yes. I just corrected the impression on the top of page 2. I think what I asked was what kind of a cumulative impact Cape Elizabeth development adds to the traffic. That's the first paragraph.
Fine. Do I hear a motion to accept those minutes as amended by Mrs. Rand? Thank you. Seconded. All in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Speaking of our secretary for the planning board, I want to thank Jane Cronin, who has been our secretary here for years. And Jane has a flourishing business here in Cape Elizabeth, and she is serving as our secretary only temporarily. But should a new secretary be hired, and this is a commercial for anyone out there in the world of TV, we are desperate for a secretary. But I want to thank Jane so very much for her years of conscientious and dedicated service to the planning board. She's always been very pleasant. She has a great sense of humor, and her generosity will never be forgotten because she has supplied the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board with candy for years. Thank you, Jane, and good luck with your business. We will really miss you. Okay, now on to correspondence. I would like to acknowledge a rather lengthy list of correspondence. We received a notice from Mereda regarding a seminar on impact fees, a letter from Bates College regarding a program on land use, a notice from COG, a workshop on coastal marine resources, another notice from COG dated March 24th concerning a zoning board workshop, a notice from the DEP having to do with the issue profile on Mandatory Shoreland Zoning Act, another from COG, technical assistance for planning boards on evaluating impact of development on lakes, a memo from Michael McGovern, our town manager, regarding public versus private roads, a letter dated March 22nd from Michael McGovern, town manager, regarding the need for a second full Broad Cove access, a letter dated March 24th from Joel Russ indicating that he was submitting his resignation from the planning board. As some of you probably already know, Joel has accepted a very exciting position with the Maine Chamber of Commerce. As a matter of fact, there was an article in the paper just tonight about that. Joel, if you're listening, we want to thank you so very, very much for the time and energy and the intelligence that you brought to the planning board. And we will miss you, but we're glad that the rest of Maine will know you. And we wish you well. Thank you, Joel. And then lastly, a letter just tonight from George Marcus concerning a right-of-way at Broad Cove and the Greater Portland Development Group. And that's the end of the lengthy list of correspondence. It appears that on our agenda this evening, Mr. William Gaynor, who was proposing an office conversion at 1235 Shore Road, will not be here tonight. So I'd like to ask the planning board if we could possibly take items out of order and move our future workshop discussion up to this place. So do I hear a motion to take items out of order and discuss the workshops?
Marion, are the people here for the 7:30 item?
Is Mr. Kimball here?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Would you prefer to be on now?
I would think that it might be better to take whoever's here first and then...
Sure. That's fine. Would you like to come up, Mr. Kimball? Maybe while you're preparing your notes, our planner, Steve Butler, could fill us in on Mr. Kimball's review.
Sure.
Could you?
I'll try and do it briefly. I have a request by Robert Kimball to add an additional apartment unit to an existing structure, which is located at 300 Ocean House Road, which is the structure that's sandwiched between the mobile gas station and the Gable property, which we were to occur just this evening as well. It's located in a business A zone, which requires site plan approval by the planning board. The building now has two apartments and one hairstyling establishment. The apartment unit that's being proposed would be in an already existing space. The space is vacant at this point, or relatively vacant. The building itself is a grandfathered structure with respect to existing uses, but the new apartment unit does require site plan approval, which triggers the need to comply with the town standards in such areas as parking, site distance, and things of this nature. Mr. Kimball has been before the planning board once before. That was at the last meeting where he and the board had a pre-application conference where he can describe in general what he wanted to do. The applicant has supplied a number of materials since that last meeting, some of which were discussed and asked for, things such as the deed, deed document showing that he does have the rights to go over onto the abutting property, the Gaynor property, to gain access to the rear of the structure and other sorts of documents. Some outstanding issues that Madam Chairman, you asked me to perhaps just highlight,
yes.
And I'm sure Mr. Kimball will go in much more detail. The issues, some of them were highlighted by the letter from Bob Hunter, which I think you received over the weekend, deal with the parking area aspect of the proposal. And in order to fulfill the parking requirements of the zoning ordinance, the applicant will need to expand the parking area, which will involve the expansion of the existing bank outward to accommodate more more area so the number of spaces can be provided. And that's going to involve some filling, as I said, and also the construction of a retaining wall. And one of the aspects that the town engineer brought up was that he felt that he wanted more information in terms of the design of that structure. Secondly, the issue with respect to the use of the abutting property, Mr. Gaynor's property, for parking purposes, something that was brought up the last time in terms of the 4 to 6 spaces that was mentioned by an older agreement, that's something that that agreement, I believe, needs to be strengthened, and that's something that Mr. Kimball, I think, will talk about in terms of making sure that the 4 to 6 spaces will continually be able to be provided and that there won't be any problem down the road in terms of gaining access to those. Some other points just quickly. Access to the parking area is somewhat narrow. It's really, there's enough space for a vehicle, but only for one vehicle at a time. So if there are two vehicles at opposite times, there'd have to be some delineation in terms of which car would have priority. Town engineer also details about drainage and site grading. And finally, the town engineer also mentioned wanting to see more information shown on the applicant's plans. And that was his preference. And so those are, in essence, some of the outstanding issues. The microphone's echoing away, so I'll back off. I guess tonight, your options are either to approve with conditions, table, or disapprove. think those, you know, we can talk about more of those later after the applicant makes a presentation.
Right. Well, with that, Mr. Kimball, welcome back.
Good evening, Chairwoman, and ladies and gentlemen of the board. In the last meeting, there were a few issues that were brought up and that concerned the parking spaces themselves. One of the questions that was asked during the last meeting is, could the parking spaces be extended from 16 feet to 18 feet? And after reviewing the site plans, it's evident that if we do extend the parking spots to 18 feet, there'll be 28 feet in which the car can maneuver its way back out onto the street and down the drive. Another one of the major concerns that you brought up yourself was the fact that if two cars approach each other in the driveway from opposite direction, what would prevent the driver of the car coming into the parking facility from backing onto the shore road? What we'll do there is, you can see in the site plan that there's a jog in the building, and there's about, I think there's 21 feet, and in that space right there, we put a sign, yield to oncoming traffic, so that the driver, he or she may see this sign, and when a car is approaching in to the parking facility, they will yield to the car coming up, so there won't be any problem with the car having to back down onto the street. Would that be sufficient enough in protecting the driver from backing down into the shore road?
Are you asking
yes.
me? Well, I don't know, but it seems to me, if you think of the worst case scenario, which would be a winter scene, let's say that the person doesn't make it to the jog, let's just say that a person has just come into the driveway, and that's quite a hill, and there's another car that has just gone by that jog. How can that car back up the hill unless it's a four-wheel drive, especially in winter conditions? I know my car won't back up a slippery hill, and that still remains my main concern with your project. That happens to be a very bad corner, which is not your fault. But a lot of school buses, you know, are stopped there, and I would just hate to have cars backing down from the driveway. The only thing that I can think of is that the driveway could be widened. Don't you have a garage there? Of course, that's very expensive to remove it, but I think that it would make for a wider driveway. But I haven't measured it. So that's the only answer I can give you.
Okay. If the automobile reaches that, it gets that far down into the driveway, it becomes wide enough where two cars can pass. In the beginning of the driveway, it can accommodate two cars. If you see now, you'll see that as you ride by this evening, in fact, as I rode by this evening, there were two cars parked in the driveway, one in the driveway entranceway and one off to the side of the building. So if it does occur to happen that low down onto the property in the entrance of the facility, I don't think there'll be any problem because one car will be able to pull over and the other car will be able to go up by without having to back up between the house and the small retaining wall that Bill Gaynor has. That's the only thing I can think of doing because the existing structure, it has a foundation and there's a room above it, which is which is one of the bedrooms of the second floor.
Oh God, yeah.
So that would be an extensive remodeling to do that. But at the bottom, it's approximately 28 feet wide, which would enable a car to pull over to the side as the one is coming in, and they'd be able to pass each other, and one could go up into the parking facility.
Well, I'm not an expert on this. I'm just using what I think is common sense, but I think it would be very good if the police department looked at it.
Excuse me, Madam Chairman, did Mr. Hunter at all, did you discuss this problem?
But,
would that be something that he might comment on, too?
He could probably comment on that, as well as the local police department, which, you know, is very happy to comment on.
Okay. One of the other improvements that we will make that may alleviate this problem is Bill Gaynor and I have discussed on his westerly lot line, there's a small pine tree in the corner, and we've discussed that we're going to round the corner out a little bit more so the people that do come from Shore Road into the parking facility will be able to make that corner a lot easier than it is right now. And with that added turning ability,
Yes.
If there is a car at the bottom, it would be even a lot easier to pass each other at the bottom of the driveway.
Yes, we saw that during our site walk.
Okay.
Is there any possibility that you and Mr. Gaynor could share a driveway some way?
I don't think so.
No.
Because the only way I could get to his property would be out from where he's making his new driveway compared to where his existing driveway is, but I'd have to drive all the way out around the back of his property.
Do you have more to present?
In terms of the letter that I received on Friday, April 14th, from Mr. Robert Hunter, they're addressing the fact that they would like me to, it mentions here, it is in our opinion that the site design of both lots should be fully coordinated and brought to the same level of design. This would include a detailed proposed site grading of each lot and disposition of drainage. Now, what that entails is probably a surveyor to come out there and survey the property. Since I'm not changing any of the existing elevations, and I'm only extending one elevation to the one side of my property line, I wondered if you could reconsider this stipulation that has been placed upon me by the town engineer. If a site view or a site walk where I could show you what the retaining wall will entail and how it's designed, would that suffice?
That would be entirely up to the planning board.
Some of us were able to sort of infringe on your property at a previous site walk when we visited Mr. Gaynor's property. And I think one thing that concerns me, and I guess Mr. Hunter also, is the drainage, in that there's quite a drop-off towards Mr. Jones' gas or service station. And you've indicated that perhaps you're going to crib it and take out some trees and so forth, but I think, and also try to take care of some of the drainage, but I think because of the complexity of this corner, I think it would be a lot better if we could have someone who is an engineer make explicit suggestions as to how that could be handled. I think another factor is that the driveway being dirt, we have to be concerned about any water washing down and taking debris and so forth onto Shore Road, that sort of thing. So there's a lot, it's a difficult site, and I think we're all appreciative of that. But I, for one, feel that perhaps other planning board members should look at this, too, to see whether they feel, this is just my opinion, that we should have a better presentation of how to take care of drainage on this site.
Okay.
I was also on that site walk and totally agree with what Mrs. Rand has said.
Okay. I guess I have no choice.
It seems like such a small thing, but you see, what we plan here is forever.
Okay. In addressing some of the concerns that you did mention, in terms of any type of debris running off to the driveway will be, it'll be probably 3/8-inch stone, crushed stone. So at this present time, there is no real water drainage problem, and there never has been, coming down to the driveway onto Shore Road. And if there's an additional 3/8-inch piece stone put all the way up to the driveway, and the existing area in the back has been built by all fill in clean gravel. So even after a torrential downpours, if you walk out back there, the water is drained through this soil very quickly. So there are no problems with real water drainage or storm drainage. That's why when you ask for a detailed plan of storm drainage systems, is it really necessary? If we walked up there after a rainstorm, it's dry as can be because it's all built on, it's all fill out back there where they had taken the ledge from the streets and they brought it out back. So water drainage really isn't a problem except for the driveway. And what we're doing with the driveway, as I mentioned in the plans, is that approximately one halfway up the driveway where it still slopes down towards the front of Shore Road, we're going to change the slope and the elevation to slope down towards the back of the parking lot. And that's where most of the water drainage will run off, if there is any runoff. But since it is all gravel and all fill, there is really no runoff because it just saturates the soil.
Mr. Boxer, do you have a question?
I looked fairly closely at both of those properties. And I think I understand that a small project like this still causes us some of the same difficulties. And the immediate reaction that I had when I looked at it was what happens in a big rainstorm. And absent the kind of engineering data, which it's frustrating for a small project to have to go through, we don't have anything for the town engineer or our code enforcement officer or others to look at and make a determination. We don't have drainage calculations or some schematics of what happens to it. And so it's a little difficult for us, and I'm not sure that we can just basically take your word for it. It puts us in an awkward position because, as it is, you ought to be aware of this, that the level of detail and the kind of schematics, and I don't mean this disparagingly, the sort of the non-professional, and sometimes it's nice to have somebody not have to go out and hire a land use planner to design two parking spaces, but that puts us at a handicap. And so when our engineer raises some questions and we go out and look at it, absent some kind of drainage calculations that indicate that that there isn't a problem or some professional opinion, we're sort of stymied because we don't want to be in the position of coming back and having people say, you get all this horrible sediment running into Shore Road every time there's a big rainstorm, what did you guys approve there? And one of our ways of bringing everything up to standards, unfortunately for people like you, is to really have an opportunity during a revision to a grandfathered site to maybe require what should have been required originally. And I realize it doesn't make you feel any better, but I share the same concerns, and I think the only thing that can really make us feel comfortable is an opinion from a professional engineer or some calculations of some sort indicating in some objective way that there won't be a problem. And because we just, we haven't gone out and looked at it. Maybe the thing to do is to get out there during a torrential rainstorm and be on call, but absent that, I think we do need the stuff that our engineer asked for. We have some flexibility. I would certainly be willing to be flexible, and I'm not saying you should go out and hire a major planning organization to provide us with this kind of stuff, which we get on most projects. But on the other hand, something of great concern, like erosion, we do need a little bit more specificity on.
And that would also include the retaining wall design.
Retaining wall design also?
Yeah.
Okay.
And incidentally, thank you, Mr. Boxer. I think that you have done an absolutely fabulous job on redoing that. It's a very charming place.
Thank you.
Practically a landmark in Cape Elizabeth. You have my compliments.
Thank you. So is there anything else I need to do?
One thing you may want to do is, if you and Steve talk, I was just going to suggest that we make our planner available to give you the guidance on the minimum. I don't like to use that word, but on a very small project, I think I'm safe using
Please use the minimum.
The minimum that would satisfy our engineer.
Okay.
I think also it might be helpful if you could put your plan in perspective to those around you, just show who borders you right in around the neighborhood there, who is on your border.
There isn't.
Mr. Jones.
There isn't.
Got something like that?
There should be a detailed map there that has all three properties and existing.
With the names.
Oh, with the names.
Right.
Okay.
So that we know what we're talking about.
Okay.
And all your neighbors, so that we know your abutters.
Okay.
Okay?
Yes.
Steve, I would also think it would be very important for Officer Vaughn or someone from the police department to look at that driveway.
Okay.
The police chief has done that already, and he said he'd be more than willing to provide a written report
Good.
The planning board so requested.
So see, then you don't have to hire a traffic engineer.
Thank you.
If we get a letter from the public safety people saying that as proposed, there's no problem, then we usually go with that.
Okay.
Are there any other questions or comments from members of the planning board? Or you, Mr.?
I would.
Oh, yes. Go ahead, Judith.
As the rookie, I sort of keep my mouth quiet over here.
Don't do that.
But when I reviewed this, I felt the same dilemma that I'm sure the rest of us are feeling, which is it's a very innocent project in so many ways. You're not asking for much, barely changing anything. Yet, and to have to ask you to do this is, I really spent quite a bit of time going, oh, are you being overreactive? Are you being underreactive? And I would endorse, and I'm not sure how minimal you can be, but I don't think you have to go through, again, these enormous plans and thousands of dollars of surveyors and geologists and core borings and all this other business.
Okay.
But just to satisfy what we're looking for.
Okay.
Which is,
okay, I'd be more than willing to do that. If I can keep it economically feasible. That's where I'm having a little trouble right now.
Do you have a copy of the ordinance, section of the ordinance?
I'm not sure if
that's your
ask
site
me.
Plan. That would be very helpful. You know, what you have to adhere to in the ordinance. So if we could provide...
Mr. Kimball and I have talked. We've referred to it. I don't know if he has an actual copy.
Yeah. I think you did give me a couple. Are those the copies? Would they have all the stipulations of what you have to...
That would just be the checklist itself. It wouldn't be the ordinance, you know, the actual ordinance language. It would just be the abbreviated checklist.
Okay.
Any other questions?
No, I think that's it.
Comments? Yes?
Just one thing that I want to bring up to the board. When I said in terms of possible actions, I rushed things a little bit. There are two things that could be done. One would be to make a decision, one which could be to table, which is, I think, where the board's going.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of the first action, though, at some point the board will need to make a determination regarding application completeness. And that's something that the board might want to take just a moment to look at to see if there's anything that isn't already alluded to in your other comments, anything on the checklist that either you think definitely should be provided, or if you think that for the most part everything's pretty much has been provided. There's one empty space and I guess three partials.
I wonder if I could ask one more question also. I know I'm supposed to probably have the acceptance of the parking facility and the designated parking spots, which I need 11. But I'm wondering if I could ask the board if I could continue renovations in the inside of the building in order to complete the project. What I've done so far is I've spoken to Ernie McVeigh, and he's somewhat given me a cease and desist order in order not to complete any more work. At this point in time, do you feel that with the little bit of additional information that you do need, would you let me continue to refurbish the inside of the building? No. Okay.
Sorry.
I had to ask. I had to ask. You always have to ask whether it's a yes or a no. All right. Just to check.
Before we go any further, I'd like to appoint Judith Wyman a full voting member this evening of the planning board. Any more comments? Do I hear a motion?
Does Mr. Butler have some particular items on this checklist that he feels Mr. Kimball need pay particular attention to other than what we've discussed?
I think, just to clarify, I think the board is pretty, well, number one, in terms of building plans and elevations, elevations haven't been provided. It is an existing structure, and in the past, the board has pretty much waived that or actually deemed it to be okay. Technically, it's partial, and I have to be the technical nitpicker. So if you know that becomes an okay, I think that would clarify it from your perspective. Existing physical features on the site and within 200 feet thereof, he's shown pretty much on the site itself. The town engineer may want slightly additional information, so I'm not sure, again, whether to keep that partial or barring anything that the town engineer would want. That's pretty much taken care of. Topography, again, is something that the town engineer may look for, but otherwise might not be all that necessary, except with respect to drainage. So I'm not, again, unless there's anything else that the board has. And then evidence of right title and interest, I think, should remain a partial. Because one small piece that remains regards that in the parking agreement, it needs to be, I think, in my opinion, needs to be clarified between Mr. Gaynor and Mr. Kimball. But if the other three in the space is pretty much, pending the town engineer's opinion, are deemed to be okay by the planning board, I think that will clarify things on both sides, so we wouldn't have to go to the next.
Right.
Okay.
I would make a motion that we table the application of Mr. Kimball.
Do I hear a second?
To whenever he wishes to return.
As soon as possible. Tomorrow? Next day?
Table would normally go to the next meeting.
Yeah. Is there a second to that?
Judy seconds.
Motion. Yes. Judy seconds it. All in favor of that motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Against? Unanimous. Well, I guess we'll see you next month,
Mr.
Kimball. We look forward to it.
Okay.
Good luck.
Thank you very much. Good night.
For the applicant's information, the next submission deadline is April 28th, which will be a week from this Friday.
And I think it would be very helpful if you did get a copy of the ordinance that this planning board has to adhere to. Okay, thank you. Okay. The next item of business is the Cape Elizabeth School Department, which is scheduled for 7:50. Do I hear is anyone from? Oh,
yeah.
Great. Would you like to come up? We'll take you early.
Good.
Wonderful. I keep hoping that I will have this future workshop discussion, but
we're back again.
Everyone.
Steve,
yes, I will call on our planner to give us some details.
Very little history, since this is a pre-application conference, and we have a very able applicant who's going to fill the board in on what's happening. Just to clarify it, and I know it will be clarified, the school department is proposing a temporary classroom structure to the middle school in the rear, to the rear portion of the building, back near the Industrial Arts Building. The original set of drawings show two different locations, and I think in most years I tried to highlight which one we were really looking at. This sort of improvement does require site plan approval, but it also requires conditional use approval, and as the ordinance is set up now, the zoning board, or the Board of Zoning Appeals, is required to make a decision first, and that's why we felt one, the board couldn't make a decision tonight, but we also felt that it was important that the school department have an opportunity to discuss its plans with the board ahead of schedule, so they could come back before the board in May and be able to move things along very quickly.
Thank you, Steve, and welcome.
Thank you.
Please state your name.
D. LaBelle. I'm the business manager for the school.
Mr. D. LaBelle.
We're proposing this year to add a portal at the middle school, which would be situated behind the IA wing or the home ec wing. The structure would have a ramp that would be handicap accessible. And to the left of the ramp would be a 70 by 70 portable, which would house the media center and the two computer labs. The building is pretty much as you see the one at the Pond Cove Elementary School, as far as wood structure and everything else. Our first site plan, which you'll probably notice on your...
Can you point out on that where the one you put in last year is?
Last year is right here, connecting two schools.
So this is basically in the beginning. Is there some grass there or not now?
Yep.
It's right around where the school buses pull up?
No, it's in the back of the, right by the basketball courts in the back, middle school.
No, I'm having trouble
they
following
really were tennis courts.
And being oriented.
Well, I think because they crossed out one area then where they were originally going to have it.
Oh, that's okay. Right. There's two okay. Site plans. Right.
Yes, it confused a lot of people, but it is no longer going to be
by the
school bus area.
And you are having
area.
One site that is going to be equivalent in space to the two that you propose? No.
See, the first plan that was presented to you people, there was, you see from right here.
It
we
was right there.
We have to build it right here.
Right.
The water flow from one Pond Cove is too great, and we'd have to cover the drainage system, which is right here. So our second choice, we've kind of tossed that one aside because it's creating too many problems. So we're saying that we'd like to situate the portable behind or next to the IA wing, which is quite a ways in the back. The only place it'd be visible would be from the Scott Dyer room.
Is that right where the tennis courts are now?
Mm-hmm. No, as far as I recall,
well,
that's a basketball
tennis
court.
There, yeah.
There used to be tennis courts.
Right.
I think they converted to basketball courts now.
Right.
The tennis courts are behind the high school somewhere.
Those are the new tennis courts.
Yeah.
It's behind the track.
On the other side
the
of
track,
the
track. Except if you look
track is between
Scott
you
Dyer
and
side.
Where this
okay,
is going to be.
The track is right here. And we're on the other side of the building.
Excuse me, is that structure, that portable structure, linked? I can't see from here, but is it linked to the present industrial arts building that you
said? It will be.
Yes.
Yes. There will be a hallway connecting it. And at the same time, we'd like to address the parking needs of Pond Cove Middle School in one. With the approval of the budget, we have included some money to be set aside to construct a more feasible parking spaces for Pond Cove 1, trying to alleviate the traffic and no parking here whatsoever so the buses could come in and out and the people could drop off the kids. This would enable us to have like 50 cars.
Would you explain that again? When I saw this, I have one in middle school and one in Pond Cove School, and I spend more time up there fooling around with that parking area. How are you're going to block off all those buses going all the way down? Is that
no.
right?
The buses no. would still come in this way to drop them off and to pick them up coming in this way. What we do is try to, if we get to have this constructed, we would eliminate the parking around the first aisle you see at Pond Cove.
That sounds much better. Yeah, it seems safer.
Would you be narrowing that median strip?
Yes, we would by some 40 feet.
Okay.
Still be 50 feet left.
And how about parking towards the high school? Isn't that presently? Yes. No, a little. Towards the high school.
This area here?
Right over here.
Yeah. Right. No parking will be allowed there?
No, it still exists. It'd still be the same. This is in front of the bus garage.
Mm-hmm.
See, we have an influx of students going in from Pond Cove 1 into the middle school the next 2-3 years.
I'm just going to squeeze this.
See.
Any other comments, Doug?
Any parking.
Mr. DeLabelle?
Is it going to look similar to the one you people put in?
Same thing.
Same thing? I think that really fit in well.
One structure, 2x6 construction.
Okay.
And I understand that it's really free.
Well, in the long run, it is.
Sure. Any other questions from members of the planning board?
I guess my question is, what do we need to get the approval at next meeting? Anything out of the ordinary, or?
Well, ordinarily, we receive our plans at least 18 days or a week before, so I think that even though this is in family, it wouldn't be fair to say that we're ready to move.
That's no problem.
Direction.
Madam Chairman?
Yes, Steve.
The town engineer did review the initial set of plans briefly and had some comments with respect to drainage. Just was curious in terms of what might, what the impact might be. And when the department heads of the town met to look at the initial plans, and we looked at the parking situation, we had a short discussion about circulation situation in that whole area, and talked briefly about whether or not it would be feasible and desirable to somehow limit some of the through traffic that occurs from, I think it's Jordan Lane or Jordan Way, through the middle school and elementary school area. And so there's some discussion about if it might make sense to block off part of one road or another. I'm not sure if that's something that the planning board's interested in looking at now or at some point in the future, but if they are, that's something that the school board might want to look at a little bit further.
It might enhance the safety in that area.
Yeah. I think what raised it primarily was the fact that they were doing, I think, a good job at tackling the parking issue, but when you had diagonal parking, you would have some cars that would come out and enter the traveled way, even if it was just very slightly. And the fact that anything that could be done to reduce the number of through traffic that didn't have to occur might be desirable from the perspective of the town.
These are presently one-ways right now, though, Steve. Cars come in this way and they exit this way.
But in terms of traffic from the high school to this area or from the shopping area through, some of that does happen.
Mr. DeLabelle, do you know how wide the road is between the curb, let's say, and the end of a car?
15 feet.
I guess that's wide enough for a fire vehicle to get through, is it?
Well, Mr. Armitage drew up the specs because, like you were saying, if there is one-way traffic, then you're just, backing into the flow, really. So it's not cars coming both sides.
But if anybody parks illegally near the building, behind the cars that are parked diagonally, would a fire truck be able to get through to address an emergency?
There would be no parking at all on the sides of the building.
But some people do park illegally.
We'll post them, and we'll do the best we can to control traffic.
Because that would really be a concern of mine.
I understand.
That the width of the road is
15. We don't have 15 feet now with cars parking on both sides.
I know it.
I mean, it's terrible. It really
it's always
is.
Been bad through there. Will there be another exit besides, you mentioned a hallway, so the children wouldn't have to go outdoors?
If you go to page 2 or 3 of the plan. Page 2 is showing. One, two, three, four exits.
Right.
Four.
Right.
I would need much more when they come back. Given the location, the fact that you've seen a similar building and the flexibility that you have, and I personally would need a lot more.
I have a question, if I court. I'm sorry I came in late. I apologize for that. Unfortunately, I was involved in educational problems myself. One question is, just a general question, on the experience that you had with the prior project concerning temporary classroom, was there anything about that project that you would do differently with this project? I guess what I'm asking is, that one, I assume, went fairly well. It's functioned fairly well. There's nothing that you would change in going after this one that you did on that one.
No, not really. See, these are stick-built on-site.
I understand.
Which is great.
Yeah, okay.
We've had good results with that first one.
Okay, that's good. Second question is, we received some information, I guess, tonight on enrollments. And correct me if I'm wrong, but it looks like you've got two bubbles coming through the system.
Yep.
Is that an accurate way to put it? It looks like you've got a bubble in second, third, and fourth, and one again that's about the same level in the seventh.
Yep.
It's like if you talk about a 20-person classroom, it looks like you're adding a classroom in the seventh grade, and it looks like you're adding just about the same amount in the second, third, and fourth. Is that accurate? Has there been any explanation of why they span those grades? It's kind of mysterious. I don't understand why they wouldn't have continued in the fifth and sixth. Are a lot of transfers coming in the seventh, or?
We're still trying to figure it out ourselves. Like right now, we've got 125 kindergartens enrolled for next year, which is unusually high for this time of year.
So you're seeing a bubble in the kindergarten area, too?
Yeah.
So it looks like this is going to be something that's going to be with us for a few years.
It possibly could be.
Yeah. At what point do you start the thinking, or at what point does, I guess, the school department start to think in their long-range plan about this whole facility being inadequate? Are we there, or how many years of data do you have to see before we start to think about Band-Aids and start to think about some real solutions?
I'd have to research that, but the way we feel by doing this, okay, what's going to happen is we're providing four classrooms that already exist. We're going to take the existing media center, which is right over here, make two classrooms out of that.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to take the two computer labs, which are over here, make two classrooms. So that's four classrooms. Hopefully, right now they could use one more this year. Next year they can use another one. So that's two. So hopefully the four will kind of level off and provide enough room for the first, second, and third grade once they do get to the middle school. It's a good
question. So you're looking at this as a long-term solution, not...
We believe that with this four classrooms, this should do, should provide enough room or spaces for Cape Elizabeth kids for the next 10 years.
And you're not taking any out-of-towners.
Well, no. I guess you watched the school, read the papers.
I know
that's
it.
That's what the paper says. Madam Chairman, I agree with Dan that perhaps this is not going to be a complicated procedure, but I also feel that it would be wise now to address the traffic flow, and I understand that the staff has looked at that somewhat, mm-hmm. and I think maybe we should have a report from them on how to improve that to make it safer, and particularly with the parking angle as it is now, and
yes.
backing up into a one-way street, I think could be pretty hazardous. Mm-hmm. So I would like to see somebody who has some experience in traffic address that.
I agree. And also,
if we address this with the chief of police,
mm-hmm.
that'd be adequate.
I'd like to hear from the fire chief as well.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, if you could bring into the next meeting something from them, it seems to me that's really the only issue, that the traffic, mm-hmm. traffic issue, and if we had before us something that indicated that the public safety people felt there was no problem, I think we could be in a position to approve
sure.
it the next meeting.
No problem.
I agree, Dan. Any other questions or comments?
Yeah. Would you access this building for emergency vehicles with the road that goes around the track?
That road,
not a very good road.
No, but it's speaking of this Messina.
Well, I guess I'll have to re-ask the question. How would you access this building for emergency vehicles?
There's a gate right here behind the existing, or next to the existing shop room. It's a link gate, link fence. And there is, I don't know if you call it a road, but there is some.
Where does that come from? I'm thinking of a road that comes in from Scott Dyer, goes around the track.
That's right.
That's the only road I know of to get to that building. Is there another road?
No, it's the same road, but when you get to the end of this building, there's a gate that could lead to this building as far as traffic.
And that's a wide gate, like a fire vehicle could get through that?
It's a double gate.
Oh.
Could get in there.
Yeah. Madam Chairman, I believe that was the road that was used for the filling of the ball fields in the rear, so it was used to taking large trucks. It would be adequate for fire access.
Well, is that plowed during the winter time?
Yes, it is. This road is plowed.
Great. I think that would be very important to plow it and make sure that the gate can open.
There's a long way to get to that building.
Any other comments or questions? Well, we thank you very much, Mr. DeLabelle, and I guess we will see you again next month.
Next month.
We look forward to it. Thank you. Okay, next on our agenda, the good table. Steve, could you fill in the planning board?
Sure.
This project?
Good Table is proposing to add a screen deck to the rear of the existing restaurant building, which is located at 527 Ocean House Road. The business is in the Business A zone, but site plan review is required. And in terms of the timing, this is the first time that this applicant has come before the board. There's some issues that I think they may come up as the applicant describes what he wants to do. Let me wait till that point.
Well, it isn't 8:05, but is there someone here from the Good Table? Nice to see you, Mr. Kostopoulos. I met Mr. Kostopoulos this afternoon. I went down to look at the site. But it occurred to me when I got there that I should go and report to someone inside because there were windows on, you know, in front of the building and at the side of the building. And if I didn't report to someone inside, they could call the Cape Police and say there is a suspicious person wandering around in the back. I went inside and the nice young ladies called Mr. Kostopoulos because I guess they did think I was a suspicious person. But at least the police didn't come, and I'm sorry, you know, if I...
I don't know if the police are living in the corner or not.
Well, welcome, Mr. Kostopoulos. Tell us all about your screen deck.
Okay, it's basically short and simple. It's a 24x24 deck to be attached to the existing building. In the rear of the building, this is an old building, and there used to be a sliding glass door through anyway, which is now boarded up, which I would like to break through on and go onto the deck, and also have an exit and entrance on the outside of the deck, with all to be enclosed and screened. In that area, you need screens.
Mm-hmm.
We do have bigger plans if you'd care to see them. If there are any other questions, or
is this going to be totally invisible from the street, Tony?
More or less, it's behind the building, but you'll be able to see a shot of it on the left-hand side of it coming from the Crescent Beach area. But on the other side, driving up, you wouldn't see it at all.
Mm-hmm. How many additional people would it sit?
The way I'm figuring, probably 40 or 50.
Additional?
Additional, yeah.
Does your parking lot ever get filled now?
On Sunday mornings, that's the only time which it's really, and it's filled because it's quite busy. It's all day long. It's an all-morning affair. But generally, there's really plenty of parking, and there isn't any hassle as far as anybody parking on the street ever, actually. And even when a thing is filled and has a waiting line, there's still plenty of places to park.
And you only plan to open this in the summertime?
Summertime, that's all.
Late spring to early fall?
Yeah. When I first wrote the letter, I put down 12 weeks, and then I thought a lot about it, and it really isn't fair. Because in May and in September and October, there are some nice days, and
not in April.
I'm taking a chance by even saying May, but there are some days that I would like to serve in the outdoor, and I really doubt very much if it would ever be a capacity type of a thing. But it would be a different and a nice thing, and for the restaurant itself.
I guess,
Mr. Most?
I would be a little concerned about the parking with one thing that you said, the fact that you say that when you are packed during Sundays, it's fairly, the parking is packed. Now you're going to have 50 additional people, did you say, or tables?
People.
Your initial submittal said 25 people. 25 people,
sorry,
I remember reading someplace.
No, that was my mistake, then, sir. 25.
It's conceivable that 50 additional people could be 25 additional cars.
It's in the worst case.
I guess what I'd like to know is, will that parking lot take 25 additional cars?
I think it will. I'm not an expert as far as parking lots goes or even if people come in separate cars, really. Right now, we have ample parking. And when I say filled, I'm saying that if somebody parks at one end of the lot, they may have to walk when the deck is in. But it certainly is on the closest to the road, along that fence, there is never anybody parked there. It's usually up against the building all the way down toward the far end. That's about it.
My only concern was if you couldn't provide off-street parking, people can start to park in the street, then you're talking about blocking a bike lane on a vertical curb.
I agree with you.
That could be a real problem.
Yeah, I assume it would be.
Mr. Kostopoulos, is there any way to inexpensively mark parking spaces?
Yeah.
It's gravel.
Yeah. And it's half gravel and
it's
half
hard to hard do time. That but yeah. You know, if you do have marked spaces, people are more disciplined. You know, if you don't have marked spaces, then oftentimes
I would do anything outside of tarring it, because
that would be a great expense for me. Of course it would.
I don't know. I've never looked into what other areas to go into as far as parking goes.
Do you know the size of the whole parking area? It's pretty big.
It's huge.
It is a very big. I would love to see a fleet of cars in there, because then I could handle it. Yeah.
Yes.
I have the measurements if you care to see it.
You know, I mean, I think that you could really put parking in the middle there. It is so huge. If you just could mark it some way without going through the expense of
I would hate to have, the only thing I could think
any
of
obstructions.
Are railroad ties, but I would have things like they would drive over and would be a serious
business.
I know
it. Yeah.
But as is, I can see probably putting 40, 50 cars in there, and I don't see any problem with it. That when it's lined up, there's 25 just up on the near the building.
Right.
There's usually 20, 25 cars there, and that doesn't take care of the front of the lot.
Right. Any other questions?
Any other questions?
Steve, another question. Is there anything that we can use as a rule of thumb here for a rectangular plot of land to estimate what parking might be in a disorganized fashion? Are there any
you could measure out, I mean, roughly what it would be and subtract, I think, 20 to 30% for just slippage, waste, inefficient use of the parking spaces.
That might be worth doing with the size piece we have, just to see what we're talking about in terms of spaces.
Well, we have rough, in our ordinance, we have a number of spaces for a commercial establishment, and I'm not sure it says it in there, but Steve probably knows off the top of his head what the size of a space is.
Yeah.
And if the math proved out, okay, we could be, already be ashamed to hold it up, because I assume you have some desire to be in place for this summer season.
Yeah.
Mm. I mean, we can check that out. I mean, the average space, generally, unless, you know, you separate between subcompact and regular or large cars, it's usually a 9 by 18 square feet.
So that gives us the number of square feet we can work with. And we
don't
really
know. 18 feet long.
Yeah.
18 feet long?
Well, you have to allow for front and back.
I mean, that's generally what it is for subcompact. It goes down. I think you can see them 8 by 16.
So if we use 9 by 18, or even generous as a 10 by 18, we're talking about 180 square feet per car. Do you know what the square footage of that lot is?
Well, I don't know the square footage, but I do have the measurements of it. Along the front, and right on Route 77, there's 225 feet.
225.
Right. By 105 at one point, and in front of the building, 118.
That you got to know trigonometry or something.
Oh, no. Somebody
said, that's a trapezoid. You can do that.
Somebody's going to have a calculator.
I do. What is the current seating capacity of your restaurant now?
49.
49 people. So there could conceivably be 100 people if it's really filled.
No, I doubt it, but I'll go along with it.
Well, doing a rough calculation we just did, we got 137 cars. You should have no
problem. That's my case.
You can do opening day for Red Sox.
I think that accommodates some slippage.
Good luck. You get 100 cars, I think you'd be very happy.
I would tire it anyway.
Madam Chair, I think there's another topic here that we just ought to touch on also. If you're thinking of adding maybe 40 or 50 cars, that might be two people to a car, and that might be quite a further burden on your septic system. What do you feel that the capacity of that is suitable to?
The state gave me acceptance for 60 seats. Okay, for a septic system, if I use dishes and silverware. On the deck, I intend to use paper, so it won't get involved in the septic system at all. So in other words, I have ample septic system for the existing restaurant right now, and I could put another 11, 15 people in there inside without any problem. But the outside is going to be served in paper. So it won't be washing dishes, et cetera.
Is your are you going to have to fill it all behind there to put your deck on?
No. Mm-hmm. It's all existing. It's been filled for 100 years.
Madam Chairman, I did go out and check, and there are some wetlands nearby, but in the area that the deck would go on, it's filled and it's high and dry.
Yes, excellent. Turning lanes for the ingress and egress, the widest lanes. It's
thank you. it wasn't intended to be that way, but that's the way it came. But it's plentiful. I'm just trying to beautify the whole. It's been like that for so long. I've been in the neighborhood for 20 years, and I don't ever recall it being. It's always not an eyesore, but it looked like a little building on a big lot.
Yeah.
And I'm just trying to do something with it to enhance Route 77.
Do you have any other plans for the part you see?
For what? I'm sorry.
When you talked about enhancing it, you're building something in the back. Do you have any plans for the front part?
The front part is going to be landscaped and painted.
As part of this project?
Yes.
Oh, that would be nice.
And the front, you saw the plans for the sign, and I just, I started to do that manually by myself, and it got too cold, and I said, I don't need this aggravation anymore. And so that will be all with the two-tier railroad ties around it, and we'll have plants in there and flowers, etc.
So you're going to remove the two existing signs, because the large white one is very hard to, when you're leaving, when I left today, I found it very difficult to see to the right. I had to pull out quite a bit into the road to see on the right. It's a long...
It is, and the plan that you have in front of you, it's, I'm going to move it right next to the other sign.
I see.
So they'll be both together, and there'll be an island in there, and you shouldn't have any problem, because you'll have to go beyond that point to get out.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Yes, Steve.
Two that were brought up by, actually two or three that were brought up by town staff. One dealing with the sign that I think when the fact that it is going to be moved should eliminate the sight distance problem, but the board might want to make have a condition of approval, if it granted approval, ensuring that that would occur, that that would be observed out in the field. Another aspect was that town staff felt very comfortable with the proposal on being done on a seasonal basis, but it felt that if it were to at some point transfer or be transformed into a year-round situation, that for a number of factors, one of them just being what would need to be required construction-wise, that it felt that, that if that was needed to be done, then it should come back for additional site plan approval. So it, town staff are suggesting that the approval be limited to, and Mr. Christopoulos and I talked, to a time period of 6 months, and we came up with the somewhat chilly May to sometimes
October.
Frosty October, and as being a, providing a good period of time that, you know, would give him a lot of flexibility and still deal with the town's concern. Another issue that came up is something the code enforcement officer brought up, dealt with the fact that at some points during the year, the area where the trash for the restaurant is stored is somewhat visible, and it's not, from an aesthetic perspective, may not be the most pleasing, and so the idea of having a fence or some other sort of buffering was brought up, and again, that was mentioned, and the applicant seemed seemed amenable to that. Last but not least is the whole issue of landscaping. The applicant has shown the area where the sign is going to be located in terms of railroad ties. I've talked with the chairperson about the whole issue of whether or not a more detailed landscaping plan might be desired by the planning board at some point, now or in the future. So those are the issues that I wanted to raise now.
Well, Mr. Christopoulos,
right.
Good. You have stated that you are landscaping.
I we will.
So submitting something about the landscaping wouldn't be a problem for you, would it? Since you plan on doing that anyway.
The biggest landscaping is going to be done on the side of the building entering this proposed deck. And I want to beautify that area.
Mm-hmm.
Putting up the fence is another thing. And see, it's tougher in front of the building because it's all hot top. I don't, you know, when you say landscaping, other than mowing the lawn and keeping it all the way it's supposed to be, I don't know what else to do.
I know.
You know, I'm right in the middle of the marsh. I can't go into the marsh either.
I know. I noticed that.
But I would think, well, if the only landscaping can be done is probably in front.
Right.
And I intend to put... along the fence, that's right. I intend to put rose bushes, these the wildflower
that's
type of thing.
That's very pretty.
You know, and have that running along the fence.
That's excellent. That will really beautify it, I think.
Same to go off of my wife.
And how about signs? Are there any ordinances regarding signs that we might have forgotten? Are we supposed to view them, or
just in terms of number? I mean, it's an issue that came up for site plan review.
Right.
And that's something that's in the purview of the town through site plan review.
Mm-hmm.
The number and size of the signs appears to be adequate, and if not, code enforcement officer will follow that up in a hurry.
Well, as long as Mr. Christopoulos realizes that if you want to make it permanent, you have to come back and visit us again.
I really don't look forward to having a permanent fixture. That means more work year round.
So do I hear, if there are no other questions or comments, do I hear a motion?
I'll move that we approve the application subject to a screen deck, subject to the screen deck being used only during the months of May through October.
Mm-hmm.
Placement of signs in an area approved by the code enforcement officer to prevent hampering traffic.
Mm-hmm.
Some sort of screening or buffering of the trash storage that meets the approval of the code enforcement officer. And Steve's motion has a landscaping plan.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure, given the site and the size of this project, that I want to move that we have a landscaping plan that we approved. He wants it to be as attractive as we do.
Well, that's my wish.
So I'll leave that one off.
Good idea.
I will second the motion.
Excellent. Any discussion of the motion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone against? Unanimous again. Well, good luck. And,
thank you very much.
I think you have a lovely restaurant, and I think that your customers are really going to enjoy the screened porch.
I hope so.
And
thank
hopefully
you
we'll have another hot summer.
And the pay
we need.
Good,
good
luck.
Night. Thank you.
Okay. Last thing on the agenda, the future workshop discussion. I think you've already received a notice that there is indeed a workshop on May 2nd, and we are down to the wire. The town council wants a report from us regarding the Harbor Commission report. So could you please read it? It's a rather lengthy document, very well prepared, very impressive, and interesting. It has a lot of history in it. And be prepared that evening to share with us your feelings on the report so that we can turn in that report the very next day. And also that evening, I would like to address the subject of dead-end roads. As you recall, I received a letter from Michael McGovern regarding the need for a full access in Broad Cove and concerning dead-end roads. And I responded to him, and I've been attempting to do some research on dead-end roads, which I would like to share with you. And Steve is going to share his research on that issue. I think it's the American Planning Association, is it, Steve? Steve is a member of that, and they might have some information on dead ends.
We have some information when we were working on new ordinances, and I believe we gave copies of it to the entire board, although members may not.
And that was from the DEP. I called the DEP. A Mr. James wrote that report. And that was dated, I think, 1986. And I asked Mr. James if there was anything more current on dead-end roads. And apparently the DEP really, it's not a priority with them. And then I called the MDOT. And the only thing that they could tell me was that if there are more than 30 houses on a dead-end road, they don't have anything written about it, but they like to see a second access. They don't it doesn't necessarily have to be a full access. But there's nothing written, so perhaps we can get more information from the American Planning Association. I would also like to address the memo from Mike McGovern, our town manager, dated, I think it was March 24th, concerning public versus private roads in Cape Elizabeth. And since I've only been on the board for 4 years, it was difficult for me to respond to that memo, not knowing the history of why we have so many private roads here in Cape Elizabeth. But I can only conjecture that at one time the town really didn't want to assume the responsibility for the care and upkeep of public roads. But then I think that changed. And also there are many areas here where the soils are so bad that, you know, you don't want to disrupt the soils to put in a big road. So I would like to just address those two things. And then for any, my only other suggestion for any future workshops would be to begin and complete the daycare nursery school ordinance that we need. And then I would like to ask for any other suggestions on workshops. You don't have to give me your suggestions tonight. They can be at the next workshop. But if you have any ideas or burning issues, please tell me tonight and we will set them up.
One thing that we discussed, which might be of help to future planning boards, is to have a guideline for new board members, to have sort of not just give them the ordinances, but to write down certain job descriptions of a planning board member. And I think maybe the planning board might have some ideas about that.
That's excellent.
So that we can orient new planning board members a little better.
Excellent. And I also think that we should, perhaps when we discuss that, discuss how can we assist applicants in knowing the ordinances and what is expected of them, which I think would make the process go a little faster. You know, things like right title and interest that we just assume that they're going to come with. And perhaps it wouldn't take quite so long to do the reviews if the applicants were given a kit of some sort, a formal kit, and the ordinances to which they had to comply.
Mary, I had just a couple of comments on
yeah.
The ordinances. It reminded me that mine aren't up to date.
I know it.
And it would be nice if we could be sure that we all got a full set, unless I'm the only one who doesn't.
That's right.
I get bits and pieces scattered throughout.
Yes, well, I checked at Town Hall last month, and secretarial help has, it's really been difficult. And the ordinances really, when they come from the ordinance committee, are not being processed and sent to the boards.
So does that mean there isn't a neat, modern 88 package?
No, not at this point in time. Maybe Jerry could get us up to date on that. But I checked last month when the Mr. Maxwell's Farm Market was coming before us, and the ordinance had not been typewritten.
What does an applicant do if an applicant's coming in and says, I want to see your ordinances? What do they get?
Beats me.
I think in terms of
1982.
Right. I think it would be very helpful for all the boards and all the applicants to have up-to-the-minute ordinances.
Madam Chairman, just to explain a little bit, in terms of the zoning ordinance and subdivision ordinance, as soon as the official revised versions come out, I believe most, if not all the time, the planning board gets a copy as soon as that's available. For the Maxwell Farm Market situation, there were two or three different changes that were being made at the same time, and so there are some draft versions out, but there weren't any official versions. We want to discuss whether or not the board needs to have some copies of the draft, and not totally official, not the versions that are the town has 200 copies printed of, but at least one so that you know as much as possible what's happening. That explains why I think for that one we made sure that you had the new ordinance language, but it wasn't neatly tucked in because nobody really had that in an official form. In terms of the other changes to the other codes, you know, the other sections of the town set of codes, you know, chapters 1 through who knows what.
In the big, thick orange book.
We pretty much deal with 16 and 19, and there's lots in between. And throughout, scattered throughout, those do get updated sometimes, and I'm not sure that those sections always get transferred onto the board. Mm-hmm. So Jerry and I will make sure that we'll see how easy, and sooner or later we'll try and update your codes and make sure you keep up to date.
You know, these books of ordinances. We have a machine at our office. It's just a word processor. Aren't these things on word processors so that when changes are made, you just take them?
They are. But the problem is that some, if not all of them, aren't located. They're in different spots. I know that the subdivision ordinance and the zoning ordinance are located at the word processor at the Council of Governments.
I see.
So I think the town's also trying to centralize all those here so that it will be easier.
Mm-hmm. Well, we thank you, Steve, for sending the brand new ordinance 17, section 17 dash something or other
regarding driveway opening permits. Right. And thanks should be passed on to the public works director.
Yes. I'm sorry, I just have two other comments.
Yes.
I may not be here on the second. I'm not sure whether I'm going to be in town or not. This whole issue, and I've come around on this, of dead-end roads and private roads is something that, and I just pass this on for food for thought,
mm-hmm.
something that there are several schools of thought on, and from a planning standpoint, what is good may not be good from a public safety standpoint.
That's correct.
I wouldn't say that we sacrifice the public safety, but in the particular project that I think the manager was writing about, that developer contacted a lot of people, and a lot of people in the neighborhood said, we prefer to have some small extensions of roads and fewer lots. And the person said, if I'm going to have to put in a $1 million road all the way through, then I'm going to need more lots. And so mm-hmm. this is a give and take. And I've seen the same thing around the Cape and other places with the private roads, too. Your first reaction is that a private road isn't very good. But sometimes it's a way of limiting the growth. In a way that might, if somebody doesn't have to spend money on a road, then there may be a way of having, you know, a small private non-conforming road that allows one lot as opposed to two lots. I mean, a lot of considerations there. And as the Cape gets more and more built, you know, I for one wouldn't want to just say automatically if the traffic officials think two roads are better, let's put two roads in. That might be 50s planning or 60s planning as opposed to 90s planning. So I do mention that because sometimes, and I think it's going to happen more and more, we're going to run into conflicts with our fire and public safety officials who would like it in an ideal world to be their way. You know, huge turnarounds and plenty of room and lots of fire hydrants and minimum number of houses on some street and exits coming out every way. And I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm not really trying to cloud it, but it's more complex than just was the police.
It is. And I think increasingly we're going to have to be more aware of the land itself and let the land speak to us. I know that that sounds really insane, but the land has a personality and a character. And if you're on a planning board, I think that's the way you should plan, around the land.
That's right. That was sort of my comment. 50s or 60s planning might be put a road through.
Right.
And today's planning might be exactly what you're saying.
That's right.
Which gets to my last comment. Then I'm not here. I've been mentioning this theme for a while, but I really think we need to spend some time on the wetlands issue and be educated more than we are. I know there's a wetlands ordinance that's plodding around, but I'm very concerned that every time we let somebody build 1,000 square feet or put the road in over the small wetland that doesn't quite comply, or build the house next to the wetland, that we're doing so in a vacuum. And it's easy to say that, you know, that driveway goes on a wetland. It's hard to say what's the implications of that, and it's even harder for me anyway to say what happens if you put 23 lots on the front part of the long skinny parcel and leave the back vacant because it's the wetlands. What are the implications of that? And I think since more and more land, all that's left is the little high and dry island surrounded by the wetlands, we ought to sit here and be able to digest these proposals.
I agree with you. It's like a shot in the dark when you vote for some of those proposals. And I feel that the Conservation Commission should be playing a more active role in our decisions. In some towns, conservation commissions vote and vote on wetlands alterations. And I plan on getting a hold of Sally Tinsman and continuing the rapport that our two boards have had.
That's an excellent suggestion because it, from the legal standpoint, it makes it easier on us if we are presented with a report from the Conservation Commission that says, in our opinion, we believe that this would have an unreasonable impact. We wouldn't let them do our job, but it would weigh very heavily on me, and as a legal matter, it would make a decision more supportable if we just sort of sit here and wonder about the implications, and they've gone out and talked around and talked to some experts and come up with some sort of analysis, much like our town engineer does. It would be a lot easier. The Department of Environmental Protection solicits a report on every development project from a half a dozen agencies, soil and water conservation, transportation. And if one of those agencies says, in our opinion, they shouldn't be granted, the Department of Environmental Protection just basically says, no, and we might want to move more and more towards that, putting some of the burden for those issues on that commission.
That's
Make them more active and make them give us a recommendation.
The Conservation Commission is a very, very important group for the future.
Well, there is a little hangover left from last time on our workshop topics, and that we do have a wetlands ordinance that's going to be hopefully coming to us as soon as a map is drawn out.
That isn't
going to
solve everything.
No, it isn't. And I do think that, Dan, you are right. There is a national policy almost now being developed in which we must take a lot more care and thought as to what we're doing with our wetlands.
Absolutely.
The national policy now, if you can, and I read all this stuff in my line of work on a more on an industrial basis, is basically no net loss of wetlands.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, in most instances, you need an Army Corps permit or something like that. You're talking about a bigger area, but if you sort of scale it back to Cape Elizabeth, I have been pushing the Comprehensive Planning Commission, and I'm only half being listened to, for a recommendation, if we're talking long term, of a no net loss of wetlands in Cape Elizabeth.
Mm-hmm. I think that's...
We could attempt to implement that if we concluded
that might turn out to be a no-growth policy.
Well, you got to be a little bit concerned if the only way you can go is to build on wetlands in Cape Elizabeth.
That's right.
So I think if we're educated and we know the implications, we can implement policies like that ourselves.
Well, anything else tonight? If not, before we would adjourn, since we have so much time, I would personally like to thank the people who are our volunteers, volunteer camera men and women, camera persons, who give up their time here in Cape Elizabeth to make us TV stars and bring all of the important information to the people of Cape Elizabeth. You are indeed the unsung heroes of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you. Do I hear a motion to adjourn this meeting?
So moved.
Okay. All in favor? Aye. Thank you.
If anybody needs a copy of the advisory report.